And the lucky food made this all for me because I don't have the time to have lunch. So you can imagine how I'm feeling now to introduce a very grim subject called post-marriage and honor-based violence to you. It's a great privilege to be able to share some of my experiences about lots of things I do on human rights. And about myself, I'll say briefly that I was an academic to begin with. I used to lecture in political science at the University of Dhaka before coming here as a student, and I did my PhD at SOAS, School of Oriental and African Studies, so I'm a SOASist. And I met quite a lot of lovely resources. Lovely Bangladeshi people, and of course, the whole world is there at SOAS, so international. And I was very excited to see the diversity after coming from Bangladesh. When I saw the diversity at the university, I was absolutely over the moon. And I love it. And my consultancy is also called Equality and Diversity. Anyway, having done my PhD there, although I had an offer from Professor Tapan Ray Chaudhary from Oxford, and when my friends found out that I did not take up the offer and I stayed on at SOAS, they thought I was so stupid. But I did it for loyalty, because before I got that offer at Oxford from Professor Rhea Chaudhary to do my PhD, I was seen by a person called Mr. Harrison, Major Harrison at SOAS, who came all the way from London to Brighton to see me when I was walking around and sort of almost window shopping for a university which will accept me to do a PhD. He came and he was so nice, and I gave him my word of honor. I'll use the word honor quite a lot in my presentation. So I gave him my word of honor that yes, I accept, I will go to SOAS. And then came the offer from Oxford, and I couldn't breach my own word of honor. So I stayed on. And I may be stupid, but I'm a very loyal person. After doing the PhD here, I met my husband in this country, married and stayed on. And my jobs mainly were heads of equalities in various local authorities, five of them, four in London, one in Bedfordshire County Council. And I worked in housing as head of equalities. I worked in employment, education, and community empowerment. So I finished those things and became my own boss by setting up a consultancy called Equality and Diversity, and also set up a lot of community organizations to empower women and men both from those parts or those sections of various communities where they are definitely disempowered for a variety of reasons. And I did not look back. And I think it's so rewarding when you work for the community and think, my God, I've done so many research studies, and yet I remained only a footnote in somebody else's research study. I didn't change anybody's life by being a big scholar. It didn't happen. Nobody knew me. And nobody bothered about who I was, what I wrote. But as soon as I started doing community work, and now my 70% time goes into community activities, I feel that I am touching people's lives the way I can. Whatever I can do, I do in a positive way. And that brought me to very difficult areas like forced marriage, honor-based violence, disability issues, inequalities, discrimination, so on and so forth. And when I was in London working in Tower Hamlets and in GLC, and also Elia, and then Ealing, I noticed the scale of inequalities in this country between various groups. And that shattered my sort of hope that one day, probably, I will just die under sort of the pressure of all this stress because I couldn't take it anymore. And then I thought, that's not me. I face difficulties and do something about it. That's me. And so I worked on. And now I feel that almost at the end of my life, I can see young people in front of me And I'm sure some of you work in the communities and feel empowered yourselves when you work for disempowered people. And that is so satisfying. And I know every community has got that potential to do, my God, miracles, miraculous work, and be part of the mainstream in every sense of the term. And that's what I am, because I do a lot of campaign about equalities, and I set up a group which is actually Luton, a Luton branch of United Nations Association, which is part of the United Nations Association UK, and through that I do a lot of work on equalities, and women's empowerment is one of them. And when the women will actually reach their potential, nobody can stop that community from rising up and up and up, because that's what is going to happen to the world when the world will see that, my God, what women can do. Anyway, having said all these nice things, I'm going to go into the grim reality of forced marriage, which shattered me as well. And why am I so interested in doing something about forced marriage? Is my childhood. When I look back in my childhood, one of my sisters was forced into marriage. That was years and years ago. And I was too small, too little, too powerless to intervene and stop it. But I knew, even as a child, that that was injustice, that was unjust and unfair. And only one of my sisters, because of that, could not reach her potential in terms of educational qualifications. Others have flourished. One of them was a brilliant economist, and I even call myself brilliant. By whatever I did up to PhD. Another sister became a doctor, who is the most petite person I have ever seen, but she became a medical doctor and cut up people and do all kinds of things inside, horrible things, but she saves life. And she retired as a colonel because she was in the army as a doctor. But the other sister, who was forced into marriage, she stopped her education at intermediate level only. And she cried for a whole week before she was pushed into that marriage. And that's another story why it did happen. When I look back, and I think forced marriage is a very complicated thing, very, very complex issue. And if you don't really look at every case, which may be unique, you will have a tendency to generalize, but don't generalize. Every case is unique. Every case has different circumstances. And I used to be very angry as a young person. That anger has gone as I matured into looking at complexity. I don't even blame parents. I used to blame parents like hell when I looked into forced marriage first. But when I look at the circumstances, I think, my God, in their position, what would I have done? You know, I ask that question. But anyway, another person who pushed me into forced marriage, is a girl, young girl, who I met when I was in Bedfordshire County Council. She was a Bangladeshi girl, a student at GCSE level, and her teacher brought her to me saying that, if possible, I'll kidnap this girl. And I said, that's very unlawful, you can't do that. So what is the problem? The problem is the father wanted her to go to Bangladesh, and she was absolutely sure that she would be pushed into a forced marriage situation. So I asked the girl, what would you like to do? She said all kinds of bad things about the father, which angry girls do. And then I said, I would like to see him and talk to him. And she said, no, he's an animal. Don't go to him. I said, okay, if you're so fearful, I will go to him. But I advised her what to do. Take her passport with her, never really leave it, all kinds of other things. Have a phone and have the address and telephone number of the embassy of the in Bangladesh, British High Commission in Bangladesh, and so on and so forth. Anyway, she came back with glittering jewelry and saw me afterwards, after 3 months, and my heart sank. And I thought she was forced to get married, and because she's so young, she's over the moon. So I said, are you married? She said, yes. I said, what did you marry? He said, well, I took your advice and said that in Islam there is no forced marriage, because she had to fight her sort of corner. He said, well, Islam, our Prophet banned forced marriage 1400 years ago, and you cannot ask me to get into a forced marriage, that's haram, she said. So the father was astonished that this young girl could say these kind of things. And then she found out through her relations that there was a very young, sort of approachable and bachelor and very educated person in the same village, visiting the village, and not very far from her house. So she wanted to see him. She was smart enough to say that I would like to see him. She saw him and had a conversation, and both of them liked each other. So she came back home and had a conversation with the father saying, this is another Bengali person, educated, and I like him. If you want me to marry somebody, not that person you want me to marry, I won't marry that, but this person is okay. So the father was over the moon. So father went to the household of the young bachelor, and it happened. And so she came back triumphant with glittering jewelry and sari, which she never put on before, and to give me the good news. And I was so pleased that she had a role to play. Because in forced marriage, many of these young women and men who are also forced into marriage don't have a role to play, because it's forced on them against their will. So you see, it can happen to people, but people can fight back. And then parents, you have to have a conversation with parents about it, and then parents can also be influenced, which was a good story. And another thing is that I met a very articulate young man in the 1990s. He lives in London. I won't mention his name. Very well known. You see him on TV quite a lot, so I won't mention his name. He and I were having a conversation about marriage in Bangladeshi community. So he told me, Nazia, I'm not going to go to Bangladesh before I marry here in this country. I said, why not? My God, you were born here, brought up here, but Bangladesh is your heritage country. Go there. It's lovely. He said, no, all my relations will force me to a marriage I wouldn't like to do. I would like to marry whoever I choose in this country first, and then I'll go. And he did just that. You see, he was very articulate and all that, but he was fearful. So if a man can be that fearful, young girls always are fearful. And then I did a research in Luton, which is called Aspirations of the Bangladeshi Young Women in Luton. And when I did that, they were at GCSE level, most of them. There were some from the sixth form college as well. We have a sixth form college, very good. And some of them I interviewed, and they told me that they were very fearful that very soon they would have to start, they would have to stop their studies. And I said, why? They said, no, we don't know, our future is very uncertain, and you know, we may be probably taken to Bangladesh or Pakistan. Because these girls were Bangladeshi, but there were Pakistani girls there as well when I interviewed them. They said, we may not complete our educational ambition and reach the potential because the parents don't want us to study too much, because finding a suitable boy would be difficult if we are too educated. So you see how fear was there that they won't be. Probably some of them didn't complete their education beyond compulsory level. So it happens to some girls from the traditional backgrounds as well. But I feel sad. I think back about my sister, that this shouldn't happen. And my sister, funnily enough, is now visiting this country. She came to see me in Luton. She's living with her grandchild, who is a barrister, a granddaughter. And she came to see me. She's a widow now. And I asked her, how did you feel? You know, did you feel it was a forced marriage? And she said, certainly. You know, after so many years, and she lived with the man she married, or people forced her to marry, had children, have grandchildren now, and still, in her heart, she knows that that was the marriage she wanted. She wanted to study like anybody else. So again, it wrecks lives. It makes people almost sort of, you know, disabled in terms of not being able to reach their potential. And when I found out in this country that, my God, quite a lot of these girls are forced to marry, it was 2,000 years ago. Came out, which is called A Choice by Right. every person has their choice in marriage by right. It is their right. It is not something which is a luxury. It is their right and their human right. So after that report, which was actually published by the House of Commons, and this was under the leadership of two people, you know probably quite well, Baroness Paula Udin. She was one of the persons, and the other person was Lord Ahmed. Lord Ahmed is still a Pakistani, and Paula Udin is a Bangladeshi. So because quite a lot of traditional families are there within our community, Pakistani, Bangladeshis, Indians. So obviously they chose two people to lead this particular research. And when I read the outcomes of the research, I took a vow almost that this is high time that I got into it and do something about it. And I live in Luton, and in Luton, it's a very diverse town. The largest ethnic minority there is the Pakistani community. Second largest is the Bangladeshi community. And now there are many other communities, because the Polish community is soon going to become a very, very large community there if Brexit doesn't stop this. But I would like them to be there because they are such a hardworking community. And I think probably quite a lot of changes are coming, but in the future, it's not happening that way yet. So it was manageable for me to look at, focus on one local area. And what I found out was that in a year, about 300 cases are reported. 300 cases are reported to various community organizations. And many of these girls don't go to any statutory agencies for support. And there were police services, there were housing department, there were sort of all kinds of people around, and NHS, of course, health is there. But these girls were mostly coming to the Asian communities, organizations, to seek some help or even just to discuss things as to what is the way forward. And that was completely contradicted by what the police service and other people were telling me. They said, no, these community organizations cannot really help these people because they're prejudiced. They're prejudiced and they wouldn't really like to support these women because then they will think that if they reveal this, they will bring dishonor to the community. And so they will just hush up these cases. But that's nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Because when I did the research, I went straight to all of these community organizations who are supporting, giving some support to these people who want to know what is the way forward, and also to all these statutory agencies. What I found out that the police throughout the year get only 4 or 5 cases inquiring about what can be done rather than support, and the community organizations get massive number of inquiries. So you see how prejudice is there from the statutory agencies about the local community groups, that these people don't help these women because they want to hush up. They all want to hush up. I had to protest against it and tell them they won't hush up. They support as much as they can and they will make referrals as necessary to various statutory agencies. And what I also found out, I'm not looking at those, because I have 36 probably things, because it's far better to look at you and talk rather than going into my slides, because it's all in my head. So when I actually found out that some of these girls who actually went through horrendous problems, and they could not really do anything or go to the police, because police used to say to them, it's a cultural issue. It's a family issue. We can't intervene. These girls told me absolutely point blank that the police won't help us because they think it's a family matter, cultural issue. And by then, forced marriage unit
by the government was already established. And yet, the police did not have that kind of approach that, yes, we should do something about it. It's a cultural issue. We won't really do it. And it reminded me of Erin Pizzi. You saw, some of you who actually know about women's aid movement, in the 70s, there was a fantastic lady called Erin Pizzi. She wanted to stop domestic violence as much as possible and wanted the police to intervene because domestic violence happens tremendously, sort of extensively within the white community, And the majority of the cases arise from the white community, not just because that they are the largest group, UK-British group, but also because quite a lot of women, just like women from the ethnic minorities, feel that they cannot express that or tell anybody about it until and unless it is too late. And they are really violently, aggressively beaten up, or sometimes they are killed. So exactly the same. And Erin Pizzi wanted to stop it. And the police attitude was exactly the same as I found in forced marriage cases. The police said to Erin Pizzi, she was a mad woman. It was quite well known what police talked about her. She's a mad woman. It's a husband-wife matter, and why should we intervene in that? You know, that was the attitude. And she then fought on and on. She got a lot of women supporters and male supporters. And then the first women's aid support and shelter was set up by Erin Pizzi. So she is one of my heroines. And, you know, women have to take control of these kinds of things. Otherwise, things won't change. When she established all these things, then, of course, the politicians started supporting her. Of course, other people came along and said she did the right thing. And here, I'm telling you that I was, when my first research came out, you should have seen the scale of attack on me personally and threat that I had to face from the so-called community leaders and from the same communities, Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, and Indian communities. And they were in denial. They were saying to everybody, including for a whole week, they went to the Three Counties Radio, BBC Three Counties Radio, and just spewed out venom against me, saying that this mad woman is completely bonkers. She has made up all these things. It doesn't happen to our communities. It does not happen. So they said it, and do you know who supported me? That was very interesting. One of the Pakistani councillors, very big man, and quite frightening looking, basically, because when he stand up like that, and people, you know, they go a little distance from him. And he came up, and he said, it happened to me in Pakistan. Forced marriage does happen. It happened to me. A great, big, huge man telling other people, other men, it happened to me when I was young in Pakistan. He's from Azad Kashmir. It happened to him. And then they stopped when other men started talking about it. Women do not matter to them. So men had to come forward. And then another woman came forward, and she was at that time the leader of the council, Hazel Simmons, Councillor Hazel Simmons. She came forward and made a statement saying that I did not see anything in her report which cannot be justified. Nothing I saw in this report which cannot be justified. When the leader of a council says so, then people calm down a bit, and then the threat against me was stopped. But before then, my neighbors, because I live in a place which is mainly white neighborhood, and some of my white neighbors got extremely worried about their own safety. They came to me as a group, pleading with me, saying that, what are we going to do now? Because if they set fire to your house, you know, my house will be on fire. And then somebody else came. If they come here at night and break up all our houses, what will I do? I said, look, I know these guys who are telling you all these things on the radio, going to diverse FM, this FM, that FM. I know all of these people. They are cowards. They didn't come to me. They should have asked me, where did you get these statistics? where did you get these stories? Because they didn't read my report properly. Because, you know, like any research, you have to really look at, you have focus groups, you interview people, you go to all the agencies which actually record various stories. They didn't read any of those things. And they found out that when I said 80% at that time, 80% of the cases were coming out of the Pakistani community, because that is the largest ethnic minority communities and the largest community with huge number of traditional families, where power structure is that the men are at the apex, at the top. Then comes the older women, and then comes the group of children, you know. So women are in the middle if they're older. If you are a daughter-in-law or a daughter, you are at the bottom. So the power structure will have to be looked at. And in those kind of traditional families, mothers-in-law sort of get a bit higher status when they become mothers-in-law. But before then, when they're daughters-in-law, their status is still very low until they promptly produce a male heir. So there are differences. I'm just generalizing here, which I shouldn't, because there are many, many different stories. And even within the same kind of traditional backgrounds, you will find uniqueness in each case. Anyway, so because of this power structure there, the men are the heads of the household, heads of the family, that only when you see that some of the families where girls are educated already, and fathers are not really doing any jobs or the traditional role of breadwinners, they're not anymore. Then only if the girls suddenly decide that we can contribute to the family income, then the status changes a bit. Then they have a say about their own marriage, that Dad, I wouldn't really like to marry now. Please wait, let me finish my further education training, I'll get a better job. Then only. So there are many stories like that. Anyway, but what hit me, not about Luton alone, when I actually looked at Oxford, because I was invited by Oxford Borough Council to do the research there as well. When I saw about 87 cases a year in Oxford, forced marriage cases, I didn't believe it myself, because I thought my image of Oxford is a serene place where people are more sophisticated, educated, and, you know, a tradition, different kinds of tradition, but no. 87 cases, and there was a horrendous murder case, because forced marriage can lead to violence, domestic violence. It can lead to honor killing, or I say so-called honor killing. About 12 honor killings happen in this country every year, and the Metropolitan Police gave me that statistics when I was doing the research. And when you see young women being killed like that by their own family members, it's not one perpetrator. It's multiple perpetrators killing the girl just to maintain their honor, so-called honor, or restore their honor. They think their honor will be restored in the eyes of the communities if these people are removed from the earth. So where is love for children? And I actually had a very lovely conversation with an imam of a mosque in Luton. Lovely man, absolutely. Didn't mind me at all. I don't have any gender to them, so I just go and talk to people, you know. They don't mind whether I'm a man or a woman or whatever. So he was telling me that, very boastfully, that his children are very fearful of him. And quite, you know, there was a delight on his face when he said that. I was very surprised. I said, your children are frightened of you. Why? What do you do to them? He said, no, I don't do anything. I just come into the house, and if they hear my voice, they will get out from the other door. Through the other door, they will be out. I said, why? Can't you talk to them? It's frightening when you're... No. He said, that's how it should be. Children should be frightened of the fathers. Then I thought, it's completely authoritarian system, obviously, he's running there. And if these children can't get that kind of conversation at home, they will find out another way, because they're living in a culture now here. They go to school, they go to college, they're exposed to a different culture, not the home culture, a completely different culture of this country. And when they come back home, they can't even discuss it with some of the parents. As a result, the communication gap just increases. And when children suddenly hear that they will be married off, they rebel. You know, because they already have been exposed to another culture, a different thing, freedom and friendship and all kinds of things, which are not there in the family. And as a result, the culture clash happens. And when that happens, the fathers mainly, and the mothers also, they try to impose their old traditional values on these children, that we are in a better, best place actually to decide who your partner should be in life, because you are not experienced yet. Which is a good argument. If you hear it, it makes sense. But not to these young people who have already gone far away from these values because of the lack of communication. And I told the man already, I mean this gentleman, that look, if you want your children to follow your values, start to talk to them when they are young, not when you suddenly find somebody suitable in Bangladesh, Pakistan, or elsewhere. You know, that won't work. So as a result, I think this communication gap, culture clash, etc., quite a lot of things are happening. And quite a lot of other things are happening, economic reasons, these reasons. They want to really keep the wealth in the family. They bring a cousin for the girls, and the marriage happened, and so on and so forth. But what is going wrong now? When I saw the latest research which I was involved with, it was done by NATSEN. I don't know how many of you have heard about NATSEN. NATSEN is National Center for Social Research, the largest in this country, largest research center in the UK, London-based. And they got me involved in their forced marriage investigation encompassing 10 local authority areas. It was a huge, huge research, never done before. So when I got involved in that, they did all the statistics and all this number crunching. I had to give them the insights into various case studies and so on and so forth. So when it came out, I was staggered by the scale of it, the prevalence of that in this country. And between 5,000 and 8,000 cases are reported on a yearly basis in England alone. And when I heard that, and we all know that everybody doesn't report about forced marriage, what we are looking at is just the tip of the iceberg. So if you think about 8,000 reported cases in England alone per year, how many are not reported? And what is happening to those people? So that means quite a lot of people are suffering in silence, will never reveal anything, will probably die. And do you know the suicide rate among South Asian women in particular in this country, young South Asian women, 3 times more than the average suicide rates among young women. And when I asked the coroner in Luton, that's another story, I straight away asked him, can you give me the statistics of how many deaths, suicide cases that you have dealt with, from these communities and the causes of deaths, so that I could have a kind of, you know, a realistic assessment of what's going on in Luton in particular. And the man was, God Almighty, save me from these kind of people. I rang him and he told me in a very nice way, Dr. Khanum, when these people come to me, they're already dead. How can I ask them how they died? And I said, that's your job. Entirely your job to find out how they died. You know, and he had a lovely way of talking and lovely way of denying everything and saying that he can't do it, he's very sorry. I went to Oxford, did the same thing, the coroner. Another man, not quite so stupid like that one, but the same approach. How can I tell you? Because if nobody said to us that it was suicide, I said, yes, it was suicide. I'm talking about suicide cases, not attempted suicide, which I'm dealing with separately through hospitals. And said that, they didn't say why they committed suicide, because they're dead. So I haven't given up. I'm still trying to find out why are these young people killing themselves if they were not drug addicts, because they were not. I know that. That was found out by sort of, you know, investigation anyway. Why? Who drove them to suicide? And then what I'm finding out through FMU cases, forced marriage units cases, because they are now doing proper case studies, I'm trying to find out really driving people to commit suicide, which may happen in some of these families, because if they bring dishonor to the family by their behavior, breaching the honor code, very strict honor code they have, what women can do and can't do, then either they will be forced into a marriage, or they will be beaten up so much or said some such nasty things and encouraged to commit suicide that it can happen that they are driven to kill themselves as well. And this is a very grim story I'm telling after those lovely pictures of marriages. So don't hate me for that, because this is the reality. Sometimes we have to see that. But luckily, when I see when some of the stereotypes about our communities are in the media, because they can't differentiate between forced marriage and arranged marriage, I keep telling them, think. Arranged marriage is completely different. This has stood the test of time, arranged marriage. It is happening in many countries. Even Charlie, the royal family man, he was, I think he was forced into this marriage, the first marriage, but anyway, say arranged marriage, be nice. Okay, it was an arranged marriage. So if this can happen in this country, and it is okay for this country, in traditional countries, developing countries, which has been using this institution for so long, there's no wrong in that. If people consent freely, without pressure, freely and fully, they're consenting, both bride and groom are consenting. And they have to consent in front of, they have to say yes in front of the public witnesses. So why should that be wrong? Because it's not, they are not doing it under duress or constraints or pressure or threats or anything. They're just marrying because they have accepted that marriage. And forced marriage is when duress is a factor, when constraint is a factor, when coercion is a factor. And when coercion is a factor, either both parties don't want to do it, but because of fear or because of coercion they do it, and threat can be psychological, threat can be emotional, threat can be physical, that we will do this to you, or your mother-in-law will kill herself if you don't marry, or your mother will kill herself, or father will divorce your mother if you don't really marry this person, and all kinds of blackmail goes on. If those things are not happening, then of course a marriage is an arranged marriage, a happy, joyous occasion. And it happens probably everywhere in the world. So what's wrong with that? But because of this stereotype about us, about the ethnic minorities, quite a lot of media people I met, they can't differentiate between arranged and forced marriage. They will say, oh, arranged marriages are also forced marriage, you know. These girls are young girls, and how can they choose? So whatever the parents say. I said, no. Because, for example, if it is full and completely uncoerced consent between the two people, and if they say, no, I won't marry because I don't like this particular marriage, no punishment will be given to them. And my niece's daughter is one example. At some point I thought she was a lesbian, believe me, because she was just telling everybody, no, she was given photograph after photograph of quite recent men, and she is a chartered accountant herself. And she looked, oh no, his nose is too long, or nose is too short, his mouth is too big, and ears are all sticking out. And she didn't like. So one day I just faced her, and I said that, are you a lesbian? If you are, you have to say that to us. We won't punish you for that, but tell us. Then no proposals will be brought in front of you. And she said, no, 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 no. And she went into a kind of fit. So
the thing is, but she rejected so many proposals, but no punishment was given to her. That is what I mean when there won't be any punishment for rejecting a proposal. That is with full and free consent. One day she will marry if she finds somebody suitable, but now she is still unmarried. And other relations are very worried that she is in her 30s now. Quite a lot of people don't marry in their 30s, but they're very worried that this girl will be a spinster, nobody will marry her, and she will just die alone, nobody, no children, and these sort of things. Anyway, so the position is that we have to do something about it. Because it happens. There is no point in denying it doesn't happen. It happens, and when it happens, it can wreck lives. So, and it's not just one life it's wrecked. It is wrecking, actually, the entire family, and sometimes in different continents. If you ask a Bangladeshi or a Pakistani family, where do your wider family members live? They will mention Pakistan, India, Dubai, America, Canada. So in all these continents, the family circles are there, family relationship there. So if anything goes wrong, a forced marriage takes place, there will be problems, and the problems will affect all of these people. So you see how big it is, the whole phenomenon is amazingly big. Anyway, so what I am trying to do is not just doing some research and forgetting about, you know, the real life. So I do a lot of training. Training I have provided to a lot of professionals to understand that when some people come to you, don't just think that it's a simple thing. Because to come to you, they had to really have a lot of thinking behind and a lot of hesitation. And then they plucked up some courage to come to a professional. So don't turn them away. Listen to them. If you can help them, you should. Because a life is a life, very important, very important. And I have raised awareness among women, mothers, and grandmothers. Lots of grandmothers came and said, oh my God, I was forced into marriage as well. Now I know my marriage, oh my God, my God, my. And you know, and I said, look, you can't do anything about it. Now your husbands are all dead. What are you doing? So you have to look after. You have to look after the youngsters. And don't get into a forced marriage situation to support people who are forcing anybody in your family into an unwilling, unacceptable marriage. Because these girls have human rights as well. Oh, we had human rights. Nobody cared about us before. But now they know that human rights are important, very important. So raising awareness is extremely important. And the last thing I did was that I wanted a campaign, a positive campaign, to go throughout the country, not just sort of shoving law through under your gullet like that. Law is there to protect people. And if you don't go near law, law can't do anything. Law is just there. But the families who should understand what is happening, what is happening to the children, what is happening to themselves, what is happening about their image in the other communities, in the eyes of the other communities. Those kinds of awareness raising should be through a campaign, a sustained campaign, not just any old campaign. I do one campaign today and for 5 years do nothing. That won't have an impact on anybody. So when I say these things, resources come up. The question of resources. Oh, we don't have resources. Local authority, oh my God, austerity budget. No, you can't do anything about it. Look at the central government, what they can do. You go to the previous regime, justice minister, it used to go quite a lot of visits they got, or visitation they got from me. And the position is that they gave a little bit of money to Luton, to the voluntary sector. And we have now in Luton two young women. One of them was a victim of forced marriage herself, and she survived. She's a survivor. She got married again, and she's very happy with her children, etc. She actually raises awareness in schools when young people are there, both boys and girls, because it's very important. And I try, with some of my other colleagues, like-minded people, raise awareness of the families.
of the women in particular, because men come once or twice and go away very hurriedly. So I thought probably they find it very unpalatable to discuss this subject. But women find it interesting. So they hear about it, the power structure, the relationship, and all kinds of things they want to hear. And I think if the local authority could train up quite a lot of people, and NHS could train up quite a lot of people who go into people's families for health, for housing, all kinds of things, they could raise awareness in the families, but it hasn't happened yet. And about campaigning, sustained campaign through the media. Media has got a lot of responsibility here. But you know how it's a two-edged sword, the media. Sometimes the twist, just a little twist, will even sort of reinforce the prejudice and stereotype people have about ethnic minority communities, rather than saying the right thing. So I'm finishing now. But the point is, we live in the age of the media. We can't say that we don't really go to the media, because media has done something good, as far as I'm concerned, and something very bad as well. Something good is that it raised quite a lot of very high-profile cases of murder cases and all kinds of forced marriage cases, which raised awareness. But I would be happy if the satellite channels in Urdu, Bengali, Gujarati, Punjabi, they also do the same thing to raise awareness of the families who watch those things, because some of them don't really look at the media, mainstream media at all. So I am hoping that one day in my own lifetime, I will not hear about this anymore. It will finish. It will go. But when I look back in this country, you know shotgun marriage? You must have heard about that. Shotgun wedding. It happened to this country. It was real. When I actually read Shakespeare and saw some of these things like Mary, Wives of Windsor, you go and watch that play. There is a forced marriage there. So forced marriage happened everywhere in the past. But this country, because of women's movements, suffragette movements, world wars, women moved forward. But in some of the developing countries, we didn't move forward that way. But we are here now. We are no longer 7,000 miles away in our countries. We have to now come absolutely to the 21st century and make it a matter of past. And it will happen if all of us work together. Thank you.
Brilliant presentation, and I and my heartfelt sympathy goes out to those who have been victims of forced marriage and on killing work. I think recently, from my assessment, I found that, I haven't done any academic research as you have, but I find that in this country, from an Asian background, that more and more women have become very empowered, so much so that their parents are very scared to even raise their voice to them. And that goes that's a sharp contrast to what you're presenting. Mm. I'm not saying that forced marriage doesn't exist here, it does, but women are very empowered now, especially in Asian families. My question is, have you done any sort of comparison between forced marriages compared to love marriages, and how many victims of suicide or divorce rates in love marriages as well compared to arranged marriages?
The suicide I looked at, but because of the statistics given to me, it is a bland group of statistics. They are saying that these deaths are connected with forced marriage or threatened forced marriage. They don't say that. Therefore, I can't really connect the proportion of those deaths to forced marriage as a trigger, as it were. But I can tell you that love marriage I looked at, and false marriage I looked at as well. Because when I was interviewing women who are victims of forced marriage, I came across quite a lot of young women who came to this country from Pakistan and India and Bangladesh, and are living in Bhutan, who are given pictures of lovely, young, handsome men, and sent those pictures to the girl's family,
And when the girls, actually, in those days, they were married in those days when telephone marriage was still happening. Have you heard of telephone marriage? It doesn't happen anymore. So the boys, the girls' side was, for example, here in this country, in front of the telephone. The boys' side were there in say, Bangladesh or Pakistan, in front of the telephone. And there was a Qazi. A Qazi or Qazi, whoever it was, who a religious person who will solemnize the marriage by saying that yes, you are married. So that person was reciting from the Holy Quran, and the parents or the guardian said yes, this marriage is fine, and this will be the dowry. So they all agreed how whatever dowry is given.
The interesting thing is, in my experience, those marriages, although they are for or arranged, whatever, but they tend to last longer than this modern so-called love marriage or whatever's happening now in the Asian community, where they find their own partner. But the marriage only lasts like a month,
or
2 months, or even
just a few years. That's why I'm all in favor of arranged marriage.
Yeah.
Because arranged marriage is with full consent, but two sides are happy. But when it becomes forced, then there is this likelihood of domestic violence, unhappiness, leading to even death.
Here in the West, the British, white British, or whatever, they're not ever forced.
No,
but there's, as you said, you presented earlier, that there's a huge number of so-called domestic violence in those communities as well.
Yeah,
so is it the fact that forced marriage is equal to domestic violence? Whereas love marriage doesn't. I'm not an advocate for forced marriages, which is completely wrong.
Love marriage. I didn't advocate love marriage, but I looked at marriages within the community, and I noticed false marriages, which also under the pretense of falsehood, with falsehood, they said this person is for example, a chartered accountant, lovely man, a teacher was sent. And that side accepted that. And when the girl was sent here, they found it was somebody else who didn't look so nice anymore. And the person was much older. And the person was not a chartered accountant. And in one case, the person actually was a drug addict. The so-called chartered accountant was a drug addict. And the child was born because he was actually a cocaine addict, which is a very strong substance, as you know. And threatened, always used to threaten the girl that when the child benefit comes, it must come to me. He used to just take it away from her. And one day he was dangling the child on the balcony like that, a two-story building, saying, if you don't give me your bangles, golden bangles, I'm going to drop the baby. So exploitation. But it was a false, and she pleaded with me that in your research report, please do mention the false marriages as well, because we suffer from this. These girls are suffering. But you were talking about love marriage in this country. I didn't look at this country's love marriage.
No, I'm just looking at the suffering.
You go to the next question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, it can happen in love marriage as well.
That lady was next door.
Okay. Yeah, just to touch upon what you've said, sometimes you can have a historical episode of forced marriages, and sometimes it can boil down to confidence. So sometimes women may remain in the marriage, bit just out of confidence or
other variable factors.
But that's not to say that they remained in that marriage and it was, you know, a happy, successful marriage. I think there might be a lot of hidden issues there that not vocalised, that's not been exposed. So it can come down to confidence. It can come down to lots of issues. So. It may not necessarily be that it's, the marriage has lasted and the longevity side of it. It could be other hidden
issues as well. There are two hands raised. Shall I? Three hands. Okay. I'm coming to you.
You mentioned statistics about honour killings. How much?
12 honour killings per year.
Okay, and how many of those related to the Bangladeshi community? That's the first question. And
that's very interesting. From the Bangladeshi community, there was only one.
Okay.
And the others were Kurdish community mainly, and Pakistan community.
Okay. As somebody who is Bangladeshi, British Bangladeshi in Ter Hamlets in the East End,
it wasn't from the East End.
Okay. Forced marriage is not really talked about much in this area, and it's
we should.
It's sort of seen as, oh, it's not really our issue. It's something that's more happens more in Pakistani or Indian communities.
But it does happen. Bangladesh is our number two. Pakistan is our number one in terms of scale. I'll come back to you the team hand. Sorry, I'm favoring ladies.
I just wanted to say the issue of racism and how that affects and the degree to which parents, their disheartenment, their racism, their protest in this country, or their disillusionment, then having to live through, wanting to live through their children and putting pressure on them to have this, forced life. And then the other issue of the racism within society generally, the cutbacks in women's centres, the cutbacks in welfare. So there's so little opportunity for young people to escape these situations.
Absolutely.
So
my God, you should come and join me. These are the issues I raised, the resource issues, and also how the parents, I don't blame the parents all the time now. As I said, I was a very angry woman, used to blame all the parents. But when I looked into cases properly, families issues, then I can't blame some of them because they are under huge pressure.
I think the issues about, it's already been said, empowering the young people themselves, and I think they are quite, but the thing is the fact that the services are being cut is such a disastrous thing.
It's a disastrous thing.
It really makes it harder.
It is a disastrous thing, but it is a kind of stereotype. It has become, because of racial prejudice, stereotypes are there already in the majority community. And some of the issues, because of media representation, reinforce those stereotypes. So I can imagine how parents are even more vulnerable now and how they behave. It impacts on their behavior. I understand it. Believe me, I don't wholesale blame them. But some of the parents, what they're doing now in Luton, which is interesting as well, because they got very frightened because of Bethnal Green Academy situation. The girls left for Syria. Some of the parents are very worried. So they are taking their girls, if they find the opportunity, taking their girls away and get them to marry somewhere in the back home, basically. So that they, if it happens, it will be the husband's responsibility rather than the father's responsibility, But everything that happens internationally or locally will have some impact on these families, obviously, and their behavior. But I will think about what you have talked about, the divorce rate,
by the way,
the love marriage.
Not had any enforced marriage, it's completely wrong, in my view. But just out of curiosity,
you
in terms of why, I mean, here in the UK, there's enforced marriage doesn't really exist in the British white community, but divorce rates are soaring.
But it used to. I told you, to read Shakespeare, you read Conan Doyle, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. There were forced marriage cases. Shotgun wedding.
Yeah.
It used to. It's not a joke. It's not a matter of joke. It used to happen.
Yeah. When forced marriages are taking place and they're investigated by the Home Office, and what's the communication or the rapport with governments, for instance, the government of Bangladesh, when they are given a forced marriage investigation, by the UK government? Is there a lot of cooperation or is there
very
other
big cooperation? And I'll tell you one thing which I'm so proud of, that it happened when the first forced marriage protection order, not protection order, the first forced marriage law was introduced in 2007. It was actually activated in 2008. Then the first case under that law, which was tackled, involved two countries, this country and Bangladesh. And the lady was Dr. Abedin, Humaira Abedin. I don't know whether you have heard about her. She was not even a citizen of this country. She was a medical student. Although you have heard about that case probably. And she was taken to Bangladesh by her parents under false pretense. That come here and your mother or somebody is ill. So she went and they forced her into a marriage and put her into a mental asylum of some sort. And that was a huge case. And then a friend from this country actually went to the FMU forced marriage unit and said, this has happened to my friend, you have to do something about it. So the forced marriage unit, which deals with these kind of international cases, involved the British High Commission in Bangladesh. And then British High Commission put something, wrote a letter or something to the parents that you have to submit her passport to us now, and also you have to return her to England within the deadline they gave. And at the same time, the government of this, the court of this country and the court in Bangladesh both cooperated, and the parents were asked by the Bangladesh High Court to come in front of them and ask, they were asked questions and which they couldn't answer properly, and the order was issued, court order was issued, that the girl should be sent back to England within a particular deadline, and they did it because the court, Bangladeshi court, cooperated. So it shows that it's an international issue, because quite a lot of us have moved to other countries, and if countries cooperate, it will be tackled properly. If the countries don't cooperate, then it won't. And many developing countries who are members of the United Nations, and by human rights, we should not be forced into marriage if we are not willing to do it. Those countries sign up those things. If they, in their own countries, then follow what they have signed up to do, that nobody should be forced into marriage, then this would be eradicated in no time. So it is an international issue, and you have raised a very important point here. That's why, from the United Nations Association, Luton, I'm trying to link up with quite a lot of countries. I linked up with Canada now, and I have linked up with Italy, because quite a lot of people from developing countries are there, and forced marriages are happening. So we have to work internationally and act locally as well. So that's how it will happen. And inshallah, I am absolutely positive it will be finished in my lifetime. See how positive I am?
You are very welcome.
I just want to point out something. Have you heard of Robert Clive, the British, conqueror of Bengal, 1757? When he was younger, stationed in Madras, you know, working for the East India Company, he saw a portrait of the woman, and with one of his mates, you know, he was his friend, English guy stationed there, and the portrait was of his sister, his friend's sister. So he said, "Oh, I really like her. I want to marry her. Can you ask her to come to India?" So he sent a message, and she came to India, and they got married in Madras. Right. The other thing, Dr. Nazia, I think maybe you could consider is, sometimes people get married, you know, willingly, but then they're forced to stay because they might not be happy.
That's what she was raising.
It may be a historical account, and for whatever reason, the girl or the boy remain in a marriage. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it wasn't a forced marriage, just because
unhealthy situation for children in particular. I have seen those cases, some of the cases as well. In my big family circles, everything happens, so I know what you're talking about.
Okay, thank you very much. Can you just quickly have some refreshment, and then we will start the next session?
Can I have my lunch now, please? How long's the
break? 3 minutes.